Good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome you to worship at Grace on Main. We're glad that you're here this morning. I do see some guests in the congregation, so make sure you greet them after the service. Or if you want to get up and greet them during the service, you know, that's okay too. No, don't do that. Several announcements, moment of personal privilege. Dick reminded me that I should probably do this. Lafayette made it to the first round of the FCS playoffs, but there is contention in our house. They played the University of Delaware, my wife's alma mater, and Delaware won the game by 2 points at the end of the game. So I'm sleeping in the she shed for the next year. Also, someone found an earring. This goes with nothing that I own. And it's only a single, it's not a pair. So if you've lost an earring, it's right here. This coming Sunday is the Hanging of the Green service. Invite your neighbors, invite your friends. We will be pre-decorating on Saturday. So if you are available and can help out, we will be here at 10 till noon. And it goes fairly quickly. And we will have you out of here by noon, and we'll have the service then on Sunday. On a sad note, Becky Matthews, who worships with us, she and her husband Wayne were members of Gloucester Point Baptist Church. And she has been worshiping with us regularly. He has been in hospice care and has not been well. He came to the cantata last year. He's been to a couple worship services, but he passed away yesterday. They were moving him to Heron Cove, and they got him to Heron Cove, and he passed. So please keep Becky in your prayers. These are all of the announcements I have this morning. Our liturgist today is Megan Reynolds.
Also known as Megan Taylor. Good morning. Good morning. We're glad that you all joined us here today at Grace on Main. If you are a guest or visitor today, we extend an especially warm welcome to you. We would like you to find the visitor's card located in the pew rack. We hope you'll fill it out, place it in the offering plate as it is passed around later in the service. It will help us to get to know you a little bit better. Here at Grace on Main, we have Sunday school studies available for all ages. We also have children's church for the kids. Please note the bulletin and the side screens as they will cue you when the children are ready to leave. In the bulletin, you'll find detailed information relating to weekly calendar, updated events, and scheduled meetings. Before we begin, Warren Deal has a minute for missions.
Thanksgiving is come and gone. Now it's on to Christmas. Hey, wait a minute. Let's take some time here and hit pause for a short period and examine what's important in this season. Have you noticed that the volume of your mail has increased significantly? Getting a lot of heads going up and down. If you are typical, you are flooded by requests for donations, and on top of that, you got a love note from Tara Thomas, our county treasurer, about your taxes. So call me crazy for bringing up budgets and giving to God's church in light of the situation we're in now. But ministering to God's people, God's children, and leading all to a Christ-activated life knows no season. Over the next few weeks and into January, you will be getting reminders and hearing about opportunities to share the blessings God has given you, both in time and money, to serve Him at Grace on Main in 2024. Today, my only request is this, that you, the session, the deacons, and all covenant partners start praying to find God's will for your wallet in 2024. It goes without saying that the most important aspect of the season is God's gift to mankind of His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. After all, Thanksgiving and Christmas are all about giving, period. So please start reflecting on what your gift will be at the manger in December and for the rest of the year in 2024. J. Vernon McGee was a very well-known Presbyterian minister, theologian, and author. This is what he observed, quote, "Don't tell me you're trusting God until you trust him with your pocketbook," unquote. So start praying, and thank you. May God bless.
Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving, singing joyful songs of praise, Psalm 95:2. Let us invite God's presence as we join together in the call to worship. Come to worship Jesus Christ, Alpha and Omega, the one who is, who was, and is to come. Come to worship Jesus Christ, the faithful witness. Bread of heaven, God with us. Let us worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
We have gathered in your name, O God, to worship you, to recognize you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Grant that in this time we would encounter you, that we would meet you here and you would meet with us. Grant that we would know you better, love you more, and serve you more effectively in the place to which you have called us. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing together our opening hymn, number 45.
Please remain standing for our corporate prayer of confession. 1 John chapter 4, verse 16 says, God is love. The God revealed to us in the pages of Scripture is a welcoming and inclusive God who directs us to love one another. We seek to remove all the barriers that keep us from that love. Come now to confess all that separates you from others and from God. Join me in praying the corporate prayer of confession, followed by a silent time to confess our own personal sins and failures. You, God, are our one and only King. We beg your forgiveness for the other kings we kneel before. Money, power, gossip, self-righteousness. We beg your forgiveness. We who are broken and torn apart by our own doings and undoings. Guide us to be your servants. Lead us to trust in you as the only King we need. Direct our faith in your sovereign power as we strive to follow your Son. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. God's word tells us that this saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance. that Christ Jesus came into the world to give his life for sinners. This is the reason he came. This is the reason he died. This is the reason he rose again. Hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
children. I know you don't go back to school until tomorrow, but we're going to have a test today. You want to come over and sit in the second row? We've got plenty of room. Okay, the test is, can anybody remember the first line from the Apostles' Creed? I believe. No. Let's say it together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Let's try it again together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. One more time. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. So we've already gone over that, so you should have that locked in. But today we're going to start with the second part of the Godhead, or the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God. And so it says, and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord. His only Son, our Lord. What does only mean? Yes.
There is only one of them. Only two.
Very excellent. Very good. It means that Jesus is unique. There's no other Son of God. Now, we are sons and daughters of God through faith in Jesus Christ, but Jesus is God's only Son. Now, let me ask. You're a son, right? Why are you a son? Do you have a father? Yes, you do. I have a father, too. My dad is dead. My dad died in 1999. But I have a father, so I'm a son. Okay? What the Apostles' Creed says is that Jesus and God were one, and yet distinct. Yeah, this is deep theology here, folks. Hang in there. They're not going to get it, but over time, we all get it. Jesus called himself the Son of God. Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man, and so Jesus is unique, God and man. He shows us who God is in his human flesh, and he also helps us to understand who we are, and he makes us his sons and daughters. Let's pray together. Dear God, help me to love you beyond my understanding and trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. All righty, see you later.
There used to be a commercial on TV that said, don't ever let them see you sweat.
Anyone who would like to do the children's sermon any Sunday, please let me know.
As we prepare to read the scriptures this morning, let us prepare our hearts and minds in prayer. O Lord our God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, that we may be obedient to your will and live always for your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The scripture lesson this morning is John chapter 18, verses 33 through 37. In these verses, we learn about the dialogue between Roman governor Pilate and Jesus, where Jesus' kingship begins to unfold. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Our second reading is from Revelation chapter 1, verses 4 through 8, where we read John's letter to seven churches that knew him, trusted him, and had read his earlier letters. John to the seven churches that are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who are pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. The word of the Lord.
In chronological terms, calendar terms, this is not the end of the year. That doesn't happen until December 31st. But in church life, this is the end of the year. First Sunday of Advent is next week. We begin the cycle all over again. And the church year always ends with the Sunday of Christ the King. As you look at the readings for the Advent and then Epiphany and then Lenten season and then Easter and then Ordinary Time, it's a progression that leads you through the story of Jesus, the prophecy of his coming, the fulfillment of his birth, and then on to the second coming of Christ. So today we come to an end as we prepare for a new beginning. Let's pray together. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, you who are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. It is early morning. Almost daylight. The Jewish authorities have had Pilate summoned, interrupting the governor's already fitful sleep. It seems he has gotten very little sleep since his appointment as governor of this intractable Roman colony on the outskirts of nowhere. It's an important case, his aide says. It demands your immediate attention. It's the Jewish leaders. They are insistent. Pilate hurriedly dresses and goes out. The Jewish religious leaders will not even come into the palace. Something about their religion prevents them from entering the home of a Gentile right before Passover. So Pilate must go out to them. And he's in a sour mood. "What is this about?" Pilate demands. "It is Jesus of Nazareth, a man who has broken our laws, upset our people, and who has caused trouble in the temple grounds. Now he has committed blasphemy," they cry. "What is that to me?" Pilate responds. "Try him and punish him yourselves." We cannot. "We have tried him by our laws, and he deserves death, but we cannot carry out such a sentence. That power is not given to us. Only the Roman authorities can do such a thing. But that's not all. If he weren't a criminal, we wouldn't have brought him to you. He claims to be a king. the King of the Jews. The people are ready to follow him. He has threatened to destroy the temple and to build it back again in 3 days. What will Rome say about such talk? What will Rome say indeed? Pilate winces and rubs the bridge of his nose between his thumb and forefinger. He commands the guards, bind him and bring him to me inside. It's too cold and dark to do Rome's business in the courtyard. This scene is such a study in contrasts, extreme contrasts. Arrayed on one side is all the pomp, ceremony, power, symbolism, and pageantry of Rome, imperial Rome. Pilate, the Roman governor of Judea, reclines on his couch in full uniform, surrounded by aides and attendants. And the Roman standard is seen throughout the room, SPQR, the Senate and people of Rome. And before Pilate stands one solitary man. He is disheveled. He has been up all night. He looks weary. He appears harmless, hardly the revolutionary type, but Pilate knows that Judea is a hotbed of religious fanaticism. One can never tell danger from appearances. His years of military service have taught him that, if nothing else. He waits. He looks the accused up and down. Not a word, only those piercing eyes. They seem to see right through Pilate, all the way to his very soul. And Pilate shifts uncomfortably on his couch. Are you the King of the Jews? He asks. Jesus responds, did you come up with that yourself, or have others been talking to you about me? I'm not a Jew. I have little time or patience for this religious nonsense. Your religious leaders have found you guilty and handed you over to me. Surely you must have done something wrong. Out with it. What have you done? Are you a king? The man seems sad as he replies, my kingdom is not of this world. It doesn't consist in what you can see with your eyes or touch with your hands. If it were, my followers would have fought to prevent my arrest by the Jews. I'm not that kind of king. My kingdom is of a different sort. So you are a king then, Pilate continued. That much is correct. It was for this reason that I was born into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Pilate snorted a half laugh. What is truth? He takes Jesus back to the religious leaders and says, I find nothing for which I may hold this man. He's a harmless fool. He's done nothing wrong. Interesting, isn't it? The only reason we know the name of Pontius Pilate is because of this exchange. It's memorialized in the Apostles' Creed. Suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Name another Roman governor. Any Roman governor. Come on. But we know Pontius Pilate. And we remember him for only one thing. His actions are immortalized. where we stayed, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Now, that's not the way I would want to be remembered to history. How about you? Are you then a king? Following Jesus' death and resurrection, Pilate forgot all about Jesus. He was just one of the many cases he had to decide, one of the many criminals he had to dispose of. But Jesus' disciples did not forget. Instead, they began to proclaim that this Jesus, whom Pilate had crucified, God had raised from the dead. He had now ascended into heaven and had begun to establish his kingdom on earth that he had proclaimed at the beginning of his ministry. The kingdom of God is in your midst. And soon they would proclaim that this Jesus is Lord, a word closely akin to the words king and emperor. And this would place Jesus' followers, like Jesus himself, in opposition to the status quo. They would challenge the empire and would do so not with political might or political power or military power. They would do so with the simplest, the weakest, the most seemingly innocuous things. Acts of compassion, acts of mercy, and the proclamation that God's kingdom is here and that this Jesus is Lord and King. Waves of persecution threatened to annihilate the early church. It was systemic. It was planned. It was orchestrated. Martyrs died by the thousands. The church continued to grow. Tertullian, the third century historian of the early church, wrote these words: "The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church." Christians acted as if this Jesus were indeed king. And yet they wouldn't fight. They would not take up sword against another human being. And they would also not worship the emperor as God. They would worship none of the Roman gods, none of the Roman goddesses. Their faithfulness to Jesus the Christ would result in their torture and slaughter before Roman crowds in packed coliseums, torn limb from limb by wild beasts. John the Apostle was victim of one of those persecutions. He had been exiled to the island of Patmos and was awaiting execution. And on that island, God gave John a peculiar vision of the end of all things. We call the book that he left behind the Revelation to John. In John's greeting to the seven churches of Asia Minor, he tells us who Jesus is. His vision is not of the earthly Jesus. It's not of the Jesus who stands before Pilate on trial for his life. It's not the crucified Jesus. It's not even the resurrected Jesus. It is the glorified Jesus who sits on a heavenly throne. John writes to a church undergoing persecution. He writes to a church at odds with the political world around it. Christians are dying. Christians are being imprisoned and tortured for their faith. Who is this Jesus that John sees? First, he is the faithful witness. In the Greek, the word witness is the word martyros, martyr. He has already given his life, shed his blood for the world. Second, he is the firstborn from the dead. He is the risen one. He has overcome death. And because of his resurrection, death is not the final answer for those who now give their lives for their faith. Because Jesus lives, they too shall live. In Revelation 1:17 through 18, John writes of Jesus, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet like a dead man. He laid his right hand on me, saying, 'Don't be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. I have the keys of death and Hades.'" Third, he is the ruler of the kings of the earth. Later in the Revelation, Revelation 19:16, John describes Jesus as a mighty warrior astride a white horse, leading the heavenly host. On his garments and written on his thigh are a name, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Did you know that the American colonists wanted to make George Washington a king? He refused. Washington and many of the colonists believed that there was only one king, and it wasn't George III. On April 22, 1774, before the Revolutionary War, a report was sent to King George III of England, and in it the governor of Boston exclaimed, "If you ask an American who is his master, he will tell you he has none, nor any governor but Jesus Christ." In April 1775, when a British major called the American colonists villains, and told them, "Lay down your arms in the name of George, the sovereign king of England," the immediate response was, "We recognize no sovereign but God and no king but King Jesus." And this became the battle cry and motto of the Revolutionary War. No king but King Jesus. Oh, how far we have fallen. John also describes what Jesus, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, has done. He's the one who loves us. He is the one who has freed us from our sins by his own blood. He is the one who has made us to be a kingdom of priests to serve his God and Father. And Jesus has committed his kingdom to people like you and like me. Frail, fallible, weak. We have no power but the power to love. We have no power but the power to sacrifice. We have no authority beyond that of the one who sends us, who sends us into the world to preach the gospel, baptize the nations, and teach the disciples that we make to observe what Jesus has taught. We don't have political power. We have no military might. And when the church has attempted to use these methods, it has rightly suffered ridicule, abuse, and disdain. However, when we, like our King, take the side of the powerless and feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the prisoners, bind up the sick, and seek justice, we serve our King well. The world notices such actions, and the kingdom of God grows as others come alongside the church to follow in the way of the King. Christ's kingdom is decidedly not of this world. You can't go somewhere to find it. You cannot discover it on a map. It has no banner or flag. It possesses no standing army or navy. It exists only in the human heart. And we are its agents, empowered by the Holy Spirit to be about the business of our King. It is the kingdom whose only power is to love, whose only authority is to serve, and whose only weapon is prayer. And yet that kingdom has outlasted almost all others. That kingdom transcends the barriers of race, language, gender, economic situation, education, and nationality. It is little wonder then that John describes Jesus as the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. Alpha is the first letter of the Greek alphabet, A. Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet, like our Z. And it's another way of saying that Jesus Christ, the King, in him all things are complete from A to Z, first to last. John believed, and I do too, that history is not, as Henry Ford once said, just one dang thing after another. History is going somewhere. History is linear and directional. It's not repetitive and cyclical like the Greeks believed. And that means we come from somewhere and we are going somewhere. John posits that this beginning and ending point are Jesus, the Christ. In the end, only Christ's kingdom will endure. Everything you see around you will no longer endure. There will be a new heaven. There will be a new earth. Where is Greece now? Well, it's still a country. Where's the Roman Empire now? Well, they are still countries. Where's the Soviet Empire? And where one day will be the United States of America? All have passed or will pass with emperors and kings, princes and presidents, and will finally be relegated to the dustbin of history. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of love and justice, mercy and peace alone will endure. Øystein Brinch of Oslo, Norway, wrote a devotional for the Upper Room on May 18, 2014. Øystein relates the true story of a time when a visitor came to the family home to attend a church conference. The initial service opened with the King of Norway arriving to make a formal appearance. Brinch says that all 2,000 in attendance rose as one body and saluted him as was their custom. King Olaf arrived in a plain gray suit. At home in the evening, Øystein's mother asked the visitor what she thought of having the King of Norway in attendance, and her reply was, "Everything was fine, but I expected him to wear a crown." Throughout his life, Jesus was humble with a compassion that was beyond extraordinary. His love for people sent him into the hands of a traitor, Judas, jealous clergy, Sanhedrin, and a cruel and fearful judge, Pilate. While on earth, Jesus wore no crown except the crown of thorns placed there by the hands of merciless soldiers at his crucifixion. The time of criticism and worldwide anonymity has ceased, but there's more to come. Jesus will come in his glory with all of his angels with him, and he will sit on his glorious throne, and he will call the righteous to take their inheritance, the kingdom prepared for them before the beginning of the world. And he will come as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Almighty God. There will be a crown of glory, and everyone will recognize his authority and stand in awe. One of the greatest names in European history is that of the Emperor Napoleon. He set out to conquer and did conquer much of Europe and the Mediterranean basin. And after his defeat at Waterloo, Napoleon was exiled to the island of St. Helena. And there, the conqueror of civilized Europe had time to reflect on the measure of his accomplishments. He called Count Monthelon to his side and asked him, "Can you tell me who Jesus Christ was?" Count declined to respond. I mean, after all, this was the former emperor of Europe, and you don't want to give a wrong answer. Napoleon countered, "Well, then I will tell you. Alexander, Caesar, Charlemagne, and I myself have founded great empires, but on what did these creations of our genius depend? Upon force. Jesus alone founded his empire upon love, and to this very day, millions will die for him. I think I understand something of human nature, and I tell you, all these were men, and I am a man. None else is like him, like Jesus. Jesus Christ was more than a man. I have inspired multitudes with such an enthusiastic devotion that they would have died for me. But to do this, it was necessary that I should be visibly present with the electric influence of my looks, my words, and my voice." I think it was a little bit vain, don't you? "When I saw men and spoke to them, I lightened up the flame of self-devotion in their hearts. Christ alone has succeeded in so raising the mind of man toward the unseen that it becomes insensible to the barriers of time and space. Across a chasm of 1,800 years, Jesus Christ makes a demand which is beyond all others difficult to satisfy. He asks for that which a philosopher may often seek in vain at the hands of his friends or a father of his children or a bride of her spouse or a man of his brother. He asks for the human heart. He He will have it entirely to himself. He demands it unconditionally. And forthwith his demand is granted. Wonderful. In defiance of time and space, the soul of man with all its powers and faculties becomes an annexation of the empire of Christ. All who sincerely believe in him experience that remarkable supernatural love toward him. This phenomenon is unaccountable. It is altogether beyond the scope of man's creative powers. Time, the great destroyer, is powerless to extinguish this sacred flame. Time can neither exhaust its strength nor put a limit to its range. This is it which strikes me most. I have often thought of it. This it is which proves to me quite convincingly the divinity of Jesus Christ. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom of priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Sole Deo Gloria, to God alone be the glory. Amen.
Seek joy in what you give, not in what you get. Let us bless others through gifts that show we care. Let us pray. God, use our offerings of money, time, and talents to enliven your church, to enhearten a world prone to discouragement, to enable a spreading of the love of Christ. May all our gifts and our giving be acceptable in your sight. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray, amen.
Please be seated. And let us pray together. Gracious God, so often we see and hear the news and are totally baffled by what we see and hear. So much pain, so much suffering, so much death and destruction. You have taught us a better way. And yet continually we reject it. To pursue our own kingdoms, our own areas of influence, and we find that the end result is dust and ashes. Keep before us, O God, the words that you gave to John. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one can count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Keep before us that vision of the Lamb who sits upon the throne, the Lamb who has earned the right to sit upon the throne because he has given his own life for me and for you. And to him we owe all. Help us to stop seeing other people as enemies. Grant us grace, O God, to reach out even when we are hurt, even when we are wounded, even when we are broken, even when we are tired, for this is the way of Jesus. And hear us as we pray together the prayer he taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Let us stand and sing our closing hymn, "Praise the Lord, ye heavens, adore him."
Praise the Lord, ye heavens, adore him. Praise the Lord, ye angels, sing of light. Song.
hope you recognize the tune. It is Franz Haydn, but it's also Deutschland, Deutschland über alles. How long did that last, that thousand-year Reich? No earthly kingdom is forever. Only the kingdom of the eternal one is forever. Go in peace, serve the risen Christ, know that God loves you, and that in this place you were loved. And may the blessing of God, Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you now and forevermore.